stock at the right time. Hello and welcome to Hot Money on Bloomberg Quint Live, India's first digital live streaming business news service. This is the show which gets you a complete wrap of all the stocks that are buzzing in trade. I'm Darshan Mehta. Let's welcome our experts then, Vineeta Sharma of Narnolia Financial Advisors, Avinash Gorakshakar of Joindre Capital, and independent expert Shahina Mukadam joins me on the show. Avinash will be here in a minute. But nevertheless, we'll discuss which stocks that we want to talk about. Dewan Housing came out with a strong set of numbers. No doubt the Ind AS method did help it with the numbers. The other stock was Sun Pharma. We'll discuss how the results pan out. United Breweries trading at record highs. Will the rally continue? And real estate as a pack has been doing well of late. We're asking our guest which is the best real estate stock if someone has to accumulate. So those are the stocks that we're discussing at this point of time. Let's start with the first stock, and that is Dewan Housing Finance. Came out with numbers. Obviously, the Ind AS method that was there did manage to help the numbers. That's why revenues were up, and that is why also the return ratios were much better than what it usually will be. But what's the way ahead for Dewan Housing Finance? How were the numbers, and what should one do going ahead? We'll start with you, Shahina. What did you make of the numbers? Do you like Dewan Housing Finance?
The numbers were pretty good, 25% growth, but I think in terms of recommendation, I would recommend that this sharp rally that the stock has had, one should use this time to book profits.
Okay. Just hold on. I think there's some issue with your mic, but we'll just get it settled. Vineeta, in terms of Dewan Housing, we'll get back to Shaina. Vineeta, what did you make of Dewan Housing's number?
Dewan Housing reported good set of number. AUM has grown up by 35% and margins have also improved. Obviously, there has been impact of Ind AS, and we believe that net interest margin going ahead, it will be difficult for the company to sustain. Though, if you look at the price to book, it is one of the cheapest trading, and if somebody wants to hold something in Dewan Housing, something in the housing space, I think it's a good bet. We have a price target of 730 around for Dewan Housing.
Okay, 730 is the price target. We'll discuss it in more details. But Avinash, what did you make of Dewan Housing's number?
I think, Darshan, overall a decent set of numbers. Disbursements were up by almost 60-odd%. I think NIMs were also more or less intact at around 3.44%. And I think asset quality continues to be strong, below 1%, 0.093%. So overall, I think a decent set of numbers. Although, you know, the stock has run up, in terms of valuations within the HFC space, this still looks pretty attractive. I think if one takes the next 12 to 18 months, but yes, in the near term, higher interest rates, you know, which could possibly dampen the kind of yields. So in the near term, you know, we have a hold on the stock, but on any decline, definitely it would be a good opportunity to actually accumulate this.
Okay, accumulate is the second of our guest, and Shaina, let's get back to it. What did you make of the numbers?
Yeah, in addition to what the earlier two guests have said, to add to it, I believe while the numbers were good, this one should take this opportunity to exit and, you know, move to safer real estate play, which I believe a lot of them are offering at similar valuations. Reason being that the numbers were good because of certain accounting because of the accounting entries of Ind AS, which actually benefited the profitability and the turnover. But incrementally, I think the cost of borrowings is going to go up with interest rates moving up, and also on overall the costs are moving up in terms of you take steel, cement. I think so overall cost pressure is likely to continue, and on the other hand you have certain impact of taxation that will continue, direct and indirect both, that will continue to impact the overall PAT. So I would take this opportunity of the sharp rally that we saw on the stock price to exit from the stock.
But this would affect the entire housing finance sector, because Ind AS would be applicable to all the factors that you said. So are you basically negative on the, or cautious on the housing finance sector, or it's just Dewan Housing?
I'm cautious on Dewan Housing. One is because I believe it has grown rapidly in size in the last couple of years. Now with a lakh crore plus on the book, loan book, it is gained some size. But I still think that some of the larger players have a better balance sheet quality to bear the strength of, you know, the ups and downs that are likely to be seen in the sector, especially with RERA coming in. I think some of stocks like Dewan Housing are likely to be impacted more because there is pressure in terms of completion of projects in time, and the fungibility between projects for funding has now vanished. So to that extent, extent, I would prefer companies with a larger balance sheet and the strength to absorb the shocks, which, you know, we are likely to see over the next 1 to 2 years before things settle in place. So I would prefer some of the other housing finance companies, rather than Dewan Housing. I would use the rally in the stock to shift.
Okay, that's the way that's coming in. Vineeta, you said that you have a report in it. Target price in excess of how much you said?
730.
So what are the triggers that you've explained to your clients why you should be bullish on Dewan Housing Finance?
So, overall AUM, we expect this kind of AUM growth will continue for Dewan Housing. The cost income ratio is around 21%. The company is expecting the cost income ratio to go down. So, in the housing finance sector, we are overall neutral considering the NIM expansion, which has already been after a couple of quarters. And basically, if you look at the valuation, we expect this company to be cheap. So in any case, if somebody wants to have housing finance, they should they can easily have Dewan Housing. There are risks because this time, you know, management has little been aggressive because the non-core portfolio is increasing at a more higher speed, and keeping the GNPA, which has been lower till date, so there is a risk, upside risk to the GNPA as in when the non-core portfolio grows, and also it will provide little bit volatility on the upside to the NIM for a shorter period of time. So there are risks, but overall, considering the valuation and the growth, we're liking Dewan Housing.
Okay, you like it. Avinash, why does Dewan Housing Finance continue to trade at a discount compared to the other housing finance companies? What according to you is the issue?
No, I think clearly markets are slightly worried on their LAP portfolio, you know, because as Shahina mentioned, you know, the property market is definitely going through a little bit of turmoil post the RERA kind of, you know, act. But more importantly, if you look at the risk management of this company, Darshan, I'm quite positive. You know, the risk management has been very robust. You know, NIMs have been around 3.44%, which is also quite commendable. And most importantly, they operate in the affordable housing space. You know, they don't operate in the higher end. Their ticket size is roughly about 15 to 20 odd lakhs. So I think clearly in the tier 2, tier 3 cities, there exists a large amount of ample growth, you know, which would continue in future also. So overall, I think somebody who wants to take a long-term call, I would suggest that maybe not at the current level, but maybe on a decline. This is definitely a more stable player where I think the risk management is pretty robust, and where, you know, if they even maintain margins of roughly 3.3-3.4%, that is definitely going to ensure a strong kind of income and profit growth, considering the kind of loan disbursement this quarter was almost 65% in Q1.
Okay, and do you have any issues with the management as such?
I think clearly, you know, the management has delivered on the numbers, Darshan. So I would prefer that, you know, somebody who wants to take a long-term call should actually buy on this company. I wouldn't be surprised that, you know, over a period of time, there could be a decent re-rating. Maybe on the valuation side, it's probably lagged the other peers, you know, something like a group finance, which trades at a significant premium, considering the parentage of HDFC. But overall, I think this is definitely a stock where one could look at it from a longer-term perspective.
Okay, so that's the view that's coming in. Two of our guests are bullish on Dewan Housing Finance. Shahina would say that any rally on the counter, use it as an exit opportunity from Dewan Housing. The next stock we want to discuss is another company which came out with strong set of numbers. The last of the Nifty 50 companies to report numbers, and that was Sun Pharma. Strong set of numbers despite the weakness that we saw in Taro. Came out with a decent set of numbers. Stock is up 2%. US markets grew despite, you know, the markets indicating that it could be a flattish growth on a year-on-year basis and a probably 10% decline on a sequential basis. So what should one make in Sun Pharma? We'll ask our guest. Avinash, we'll start with you. The largest pharma company in India, probably after quarters and quarters, it's managed to come out with a decent show despite Taro not contributing. What should one do now, and what did you make of the numbers?
No, I think at least the management commentary was quite positive, and I think going forward, you know, at least whatever overhang was there on the US FDA front seems to have now normalized. And I think going forward, what kind of contribution comes from Halol and the US markets are going to be very crucial. But overall, it looks like the company seems to be now getting back on the growth momentum track, and most importantly, domestic sales were quite robust, almost 22%. US markets have also grown, so obviously you could see a better, stronger second half of FY19. Our sense is that, you know, around 600 odd rupees, this can be definitely be a good outperformer if one takes the next 12 to 18 odd months. I think overall, if there are no more negative surprises on the regulation side, I would prefer that this could be definitely a kind of a better risk reward opportunity compared to the other MNC or maybe the other larger players.
Okay, so positive view coming in from Avinash on Sun Pharma. Vineeta, what did you make of Sun Pharma's numbers?
Sun Pharma, we're liking the stock. We have a buy rating on the stock with a price target of 750. And there are two, three things which we can look into the numbers. So Taro, we saw that there was a poor set of numbers, and yet the volume growth was pretty high. It was around 16%. And because of the pricing erosion, it has not turned into numbers. Looking at US business, apart from Taro also, it has reported healthy numbers other than the Taro business. Overall, India domestic business has grown by around 22%. As Avinash suggested. So overall growth is there. There are a lot of specialty product which are into pipeline. So which management is expecting to get it launched in the next year or by the end of FY19. So we are seeing like two, three products I would like to mention is Illumia and Yonsa, which they have already launched in this quarter. So another project, Illumia, is about to get launched in the second quarter. And two specialty products, Zelpros and Ellipsia. So we are expecting good pipeline, product pipeline for Sun Pharma.
Okay,
that's the reason we are buy on the stock.
Okay, so we'll get into the details later. But Shahina, your first comment on Sun Pharma numbers.
I personally hold the stock, and I like the business with a medium to longer term view. I think for the shorter term, it is there. The numbers are good, but it is there in the price at about 25 times FY20. It's not a cheap stock in the pharma sector, but I think the growth, which is again in the range of about 22 to 25% CAGR over the next, in terms of profitability over the next 2 years, makes the stock reasonably attractive to have in your portfolio as of now. What I like is some of the points they've touched on, the specialty products that are being launched, both in the, you have a new product that will be launched in the sclerosis space, which is actually quite a big product. And also, I think in terms of the Halol facility, which has now got a EAR, I believe there a number of new launches will come in from that property, from that plant itself, which is a positive for the medium to longer term. So I think all in all, it looks like a good bet to have in your portfolio as of now.
Okay, so that's the view that's coming in, positive views coming in on Sun Pharma. We'll open it up for discussion at this point of time. Vineeta, is all the Halol clearance, everything factored into Sun Pharma? And secondly, if you attended the conference call, what did you make of the management commentary?
So management commentary was very positive, and there are a lot of products which have been pipelined from the Halol plant. And if you consider, I think analysts are expecting that kind of, because we also are expecting 40% plus PAT growth for the next year and year after later also. So I think that we are factoring, and that is giving room for the upside. One thing on the risk side, which leaves a caution for me, because there are a lot of specialty products that are getting lined up, and this will anchor the management to have a little bit on the higher cost side. So research and development cost will go up, as the management had also suggested. So it will be around 8 to 10%, and going ahead, you know, they have this time they have been able to give good EBITDA margin of 21%, but management has shown concern going forward that this might not be very easy to sustain. So that concern still remains. But looking at the growth, and if you look the whole pharma sector as a whole, this is one of the best bet, because other players, some of them, they are having working capital issues, like some majors. Also, some of them are almost at the same valuation with Sun Pharma. So overall, if you look, this company is giving you growth which you can foresee for the next two quarters.
Okay, Shahina, what she said, that management does indicate pricing pressure, because if you look at the gross margins, that actually burned the best for Sun Pharma. Are you saying that the next two quarters probably will be cautious for Sun Pharma? Probably they won't be able to deliver the numbers that they've been delivering of the last two quarters.
The gross margins that were impacted in this quarter was on account of the huge R&D spend that took impacted their gross profit margin. But I think despite that, if you see the EBITDA margins, the reported reported were above 22%, I believe. Yeah, 22%. So if you see, this is a big move. If you compare it, like, you know, the last two quarters and the 22 to 25% EBITDA margin range, you compare it with the previous quarters, there it was in the range of 17%. Even for the full year FY18, it was around 17%. So we see the improvement in EBITDA margins is now consistent, at least over the last two quarters. So I see an improvement on that front. While R&D higher expenses is going to be a factor, I believe the specialty products will have a better pricing potential, and that will enable them to sort of balance it on the EBITDA front.
Okay, Avinash, what are the key triggers for Sun Pharma? Halol, which was expected, that has actually come in. They've launched a couple of products. What next for Sun Pharma? Is it priced in, or are there more triggers apart from the specialty products that they will launch?
No, I think we have not yet seen the full impact of Halol, so that remains to be factored into the numbers. And as Shahina was mentioning, the specialty division is going to launch few more products, so the R&D cost may increase in the short term, but in the longer term, you know, the risk reward definitely would angle more in terms of the realization. So I would believe that, you know, the third and the fourth quarter would be interesting to watch. The second quarter may be slightly, you know, flattish in terms of EBITDA margin, but overall I think the markets are getting a sense that now a lot of pain has gone into the price, and I think going forward over the next, say, 12 months, one could definitely see a better ramp up in the US business.
Okay, so that's the view that's coming in. Positive cues coming in from Sun Pharma, from all our guests at this point of time. The next stock we want to talk about is United Breweries, trading at record highs. Came out with strong set of numbers. Post the numbers, the counter has rallied over 10% in trade. The management giving positive commentary in terms of that, you know, growth will again come in because there were issues as far as West Bengal was concerned. UP again, there were capacity constraints which will be addressed in the quarters going ahead. What we're asking is, will the rally continue for United Breweries? To our guests like United Breweries, Vineeta, I'll start with you. Your view on United Breweries, will the rally continue?
Yeah, Darshan, I suppose United Breweries can be accumulated at this level also, because we have a price target of 1550, and we are valuing the stock at 11 times FY20 price to book. If you look into the numbers, volumes have grown well. The company has given more than industry growth. Industry has been growing from 6 to 8%. The company is growing around 10 to 11%. Also, the product mix, the higher margin premium brands, which constitute 30% of the total sales, they are focusing onto that. And that is also growing at a good rate, around 30% growth rate the premium brands is contributing. So overall, if you look at the product mix, that will support the EBITDA margin growing forward. There are supply constraints which was witnessed in UP also, as you suggested. But overall, if you look at the distribution channel, it is getting into place, okay, and we expect it to do better next quarter.
Okay, we'll come back to you on that front. Shahina, United Breweries, do you like the stock?
Yeah, I like the stock. It's not the cheapest. In fact, it's pretty expensive, but it has always been an expensive stock. And I believe that given the strong brands that the company has, it's a very difficult market. You know, the distribution network, to create a similar network is extremely difficult. And with the parent of Henskin, I think it's a very strong overall play in the segment. And if you see that they are launching new products from the parent, especially in the beer segment, they have recently launched one of the super premium product, which is actually likely to help them to grow into their market share in the beer segment, especially given the fact that that segment, as Vineeta touched upon, is growing at a much higher rate of 40 to 50% compared to the lower end segments, mid-range segments. So I believe new product addition, as well as the the problems that they had in the last year with various states putting in certain restrictions, those I think is now on a stable base.
Okay, so another positive view coming in on United Breweries. And Avinash, will it be 3-on-3? Are you positive on UB?
Yeah, I think Darshan, Shahina rightly mentioned that the beer market definitely continues to grow quite attractively. And I think, Q1 numbers were interesting, not only from the EBITDA growth, but even from the debt reduction. Net debt came down by roughly about 93 odd crores. And in the management call, they clearly hinted that by FY19 end, company intends to go completely debt-free. So I think there are great triggers going forward. our sense is that, you know, this should this stock should be accumulated on every decline, considering the branding and the kind of network it enjoys.
Okay, so another positive view coming in on United Breweries. Avinash, are risks over now for United Breweries and the liquor space, because these companies are always, you know, there could be some of the other risks that is there, and with elections coming in, probably there could be more restrictions. So would that be a major risk that you would consider if someone is looking to invest?
At least, Darshan, hopefully for the next one or two quarters, you know, from whatever management commentary came out, I think it seems that the volume growth would continue and they would grow faster than the industry growth. So I think unless something unexpected happens, I think we are going to see a very strong set of numbers from the company for the second and third quarter, and hopefully they maintain their margins. I think you're going to see a very healthy set of numbers from, you know, UBL, at least in the next two quarters. At least that kind of visibility seems to be strong.
What would you be your top pick in the entire liquor space? Not only beer, but the entire liquor space?
I think we have been very positive on Radico Khaitan. Okay. Radico Khaitan also, if you see the volume growth, has been very robust. They have also, you know, deleveraged the balance sheet quite significantly. And there also, we believe that, you know, the kind of brands they are into, especially the whiskey brands, 8AM and the malt brands, I would believe that, you know, Radico Khaitan also looks pretty attractive.
Okay. Shahina, anything else that in this space that looks attractive, apart from UB?
I think if one wants to play into this space, this is the best to be in as of now. I think it's got good institutional investors also in it, as well as strong brand, strong parent, balance sheet, as Avinash touched upon, is improving. So all these factors, one needs to stick with a space that's looking both good fundamentally, as well as I think even technically it's looking good now.
Okay, Vineeta, are all the risks now priced in for United Breweries? Obviously, being a sector, it's a sin sector anyway, it will be exposed to certain risks, which are could be political, could be anything. Are the risks priced in at these levels?
See, there could be risk, as in one is the raw material cost, how it pans out, because at this quarter they have had benefits of raw material cost also in their portfolio. As in, if you look at the elections that you mentioned, that could be a dampener on the volume growth. However, management has given assurance, and it looked quite optimistic about the volume growth going forward. Also, there has a capex which has been planned for 300 crore going ahead, and the balance sheet is clean. So it calls for a, you know, volume, I mean, it calls for a valuation re-rating, because all the negatives, I think, should be factored right now.
Okay, so positive views coming in on United Breweries. I guess you believe that probably the rally would continue in United Breweries. And the last sector we want to talk about is the real estate space. Hasn't been doing much of late, but nevertheless, you always have some green shoots in this sector. So what we're asking is, in the real estate sector, which is the best pick, or which is the stock that they would bet in if someone is looking for an investment in the real estate sector? So, Avinash, which stock do you like in the real estate space?
No, in fact, you know, we have been tracking few stocks, and amongst those few stocks, we like localized players like Colte Patel, which operates more in the Pune market. It's been a very strong leader in the Pune market with almost 40 to 50% market share. And now this company is diversifying by getting into, you know, areas like Bangalore and Mumbai. Our sense is that, you know, the leverage on the balance sheet is also reasonable, plus you know, visibility on the books is pretty good. They have you know, entered the market via JVs as well as on their own by acquiring pretty large pieces of land holdings. Overall, I think looking at the Q1 set of numbers, Darshan, I think the company should do pretty well in the coming year, and hopefully, you know, the debt position on the balance sheet remains pretty good. I think overall, I think the promoters' credibility and the kind of standing they have in the Pune market, and plus, you know, parcels of land which they have taken in Bangalore and Mumbai, I think should add to their top line and profitability in the second half of this financial year.
What are the risks if someone is looking to invest in this?
See, I think clearly, overall, I think, you know, execution seems to be the key issue. I think markets like Bombay and Bangalore are new markets for them. Pune has been a traditional stronghold. So obviously, you know, before we see any big milestone achieving here, I think the execution risk will always be there. Once they have one or two projects in these new two markets, that would give a little more confidence, because it's not a large player, but definitely a well-managed company.
And what kind of potential upside do you see on the counter?
Actually, we entered the stock pretty early, but overall, even at these levels, if one were to take a 12 to say 15 month view, we would look at a price target of roughly about 350-360. Now it's about 290 odd.
Okay, so another 60-70 rupee upside is something that Avinash believes Colte Patel can get you as an investment perspective. Vineeta, among the real estate space, which stocks are you recommending to your client?
We are liking Mahindra and Mahindra Mahindra Life Space developers, and we have a price target of 550 for the company. If you look at the overall, you know, the PL and the balance sheet together, on the PL side, Mahindra and Mahindra, it has a 20 crore run rate of rental income. So this provides EBITDA cushion to the company. If you look at the top line has been robust. Some of the launches that it has done, it has received very good response. Also, the cash collected this quarter was the highest amongst in the past so many quarters. So around 300 crores or so. So that that is very interesting. And overall, management. Overall, the company has around 10 million square feet of land inventory, out of which 4.3 million square feet is ongoing, and 3.3 is the forthcoming. So, good pipeline of volumes we can see on the PL side. Coming to the balance sheet is very light now. It has way less. I think 300 crore or so of debt in its book. Management has given a forecast of 2086 cash flow from operation going forward for the entire projects that they have lined up, which is a good sign. So, and in the past they have done, in this particular FY18, they had done some right issue in which management also participated. So overall, it gives us a confidence not only in the volume and the PL side, also on the balance sheet. So if you look at the world city centers that they have made in Chennai or even into Jaipur, so all of them have gone operational. Jaipur, there is around, out of 80, 49 have been operational. So you see cushion of good rental income going forward. They have two more cities, this kind of industrial parks lined up going forward. So overall, looking at the volume growth that we are expecting, I like Mahindra and Mahindra, Mahindra Life Space.
Okay, Mahindra Life Spaces is something that Vineeta likes, and Shahina, in the real estate space, what do you like?
In the real estate space, I'll go with safety as of now. So I go with Godrej Properties.
Okay.
I believe they are into all the price points in terms of housing. Sure. They are into the upper end, and they are also have entered into the low-cost housing. Yes. So that one, their pan-India presence. So it's like they are protected against movements in various markets. Got a very strong balance sheet. They're also reducing debt. I think last year they've already reduced something like 200 crores, and their stock of continuously reducing it. As and when they have certain high profitability or income, for whatever reason, like we saw in the last quarter, they are actually writing off assets which have become, for whatever reason, they are bad or they're stressed. You know, some properties. So I think I like the overall way the business is handled. I like the properties that they have, both in Maharashtra, in the Mumbai city, Calcutta. They have in the north, they have projects, ongoing projects in the south. They have some very good properties. So I think it's a safe play as of now. If I was to take a risky bet, I would go with DLF, where I think you have income that will come from the leased, the sale of leased assets, which will probably help them to restructure their balance sheet and turn it around. So these would be my two picks from the segment.
Okay, so the picks that our guests have selected on the real estate space, Kolte Patil is something that Avinash likes. Vineeta has selected Mahindra Life Spaces, and Godrej Properties is something that Shahina likes on a safer bet. If you want to take a slightly riskier bet, DLF is the stock that she recommends on that. But with that, it's a wrap on today's Hot Money. Avinash, thanks so much for coming. Vineeta and Shahina, thank you so much for coming to the studio and for the show. Ask BQ comes up next. Stay tuned to Bloomberg Quint.